to masturbate. They also like to get drunk and eat Twinkies. Not typically all at the same time, but that's a matter of personal preference. Those are the opening sentences of the book, Drunk, How We Sipped, Danced, and Stumbled Our Way to Civilization. But don't get too excited. We're not about to have Bacchanalian lecture. Rather, we're about to hear an interdisciplinary talk by a distinguished scholar that targets the standard scientific view of our taste for intoxicants as an evolutionary accident, arguing instead that alcohol and other drugs have played a crucial role in helping humans to become more creative, trusting, pro-social, thereby easing the transition from small-scale to large-scale societies. In short, alcohol played an important role in the complex social processes that led to long-run economic and social development. Although its title and opening sentences might seem a bit odd for a Free Market Institute lecture, the book's subject matter is closely related to some of the most important topics scholars at the Institute also study. The author of this book and our speaker today is Professor Edward Slingerland. He is a distinguished university scholar and professor of philosophy at the University of British Columbia, where he also holds appointments in the departments of psychology and Asian studies. He is educated at Princeton, Stanford, and UC Berkeley, and he previously taught at the University of Colorado and the University of Southern California. He is the author of several academic books and edited volumes by Cambridge University Press and Oxford University Press, and approximately 50 book chapters, reviews, and scholarly journal articles in top outlets in a wide range of fields, ranging from psychology, cognitive science, and linguistics, to Asian studies, philosophy, religious studies, and international relations. He will bring this breadth of interdisciplinary scholarship to bear on tonight's topic, the role that alcohol played in creating civilization and the function it still serves in society today. Please join me in welcoming me here to give a lecture.
Sugar was a challenge. And so for individuals who were in the encounter high quantities of sugar or fat, that if they gorged on them as much as possible, it's a very adaptable behavior. So for most of our history, this kind of desire to lead us to eat Twinkies was actually a very adaptive behavior. It only becomes maladaptive when we have access to that. And this is not a Photoshop, that's a real thing. It's a milkshake, waffle, donut. I think there's actually a hamburger here somewhere. Evolution did not see this coming. So this is a very recent development in industrialized societies where we have access to wild quantities of fat and sugar. And this then becomes a very costly mistake. This can lead to diabetes, obesity, heart attacks, all sorts of bad things. So this is an example of an evolutionary mistake that is costly, but it's also very recent. It's only in the last couple hundred years. And it's also geographically constrained. It's not universal. There's still plenty of places in the world where getting enough fat and sugar is a challenge. So evolution hasn't dealt with this one because it's recent and geographically localized. It's not a universal problem. Now let's talk about alcohol. So the standard story about alcohol is that it's like masturbation. It's a great hijack. So if you read a Psych 101 textbook, it's going to tell you that ethanol hijacks the reward network in the brain because it's feel good, it's like drinking. There are some various mismatch theories floating around in the periphery that maybe fermenting water makes it potable. Maybe this is a dirty water hypothesis. So there are some mismatch theories. What I argue in the book and what I want to argue tonight is that neither of these can be true. No evolutionary mistake story. And that's because, unlike those other mistakes, our taste for intoxication, and alcohol in particular, is ancient, universal, and costly. So let's talk about ancient. I study ancient China. That's my original specialty. As far back as we have writing, we have people worried about drunkenness and alcohol abuse and the dangers of alcohol. So alcohol has been with us forever and worries about the dangers of alcohol. We also have, in terms of this social cost, economic cost, it's estimated that in ancient Sumer, half of grain production was used to make beer. So they took half of their foodstuffs and turned it into a liquid neurotoxin, which is surprising behavior. It seems very costly. Even today, in modern market economies, it's estimated that up to a third of household budgets for food and beverages is spent on alcohol. And that's probably an underestimate because of the widespread. In some households, maybe a bit higher, name names. But this is almost certainly an underestimate because of black market activity. And unlike masturbation, you may not have gotten the memo on this. It doesn't make you feel blind. Alcohol is physiologically very dangerous. Even in small quantities, it's a carcinogen. It can damage your liver. It's got all sorts of large parts in your blood. So it's physically costly, it's socially costly, it's economically costly. And it's been this way across the world. If you look at just a very small country that I currently live in, 2014, it's estimated the economic impact of alcohol is $14.6 billion in terms of just lost deaths, hospitalizations, years of productivity lost. That's a massive cost for a country that's population size of California, basically. So this is a strange, it's a puzzle. We have this behavior that's ancient, it's universal, but it's really costly. Now, one possibility is that evolution just hasn't figured out how to fix it. So maybe it is a problem that evolution doesn't have a solution. And that is sometimes the case. So evolution, for instance, can't act on a variant that doesn't exist yet. So it's possible that we just don't have a mutation. This is an evolutionary mistake, but we don't have the genetic mutation yet that would solve the problem. So there's nothing for evolution to act upon. Another possibility is what's called path dependence. So sometimes evolution starts down a certain path, and it doesn't have the luxury of redesigning from scratch. It's got to work with what it's got. That's why our lower paths were so important, because we were hacked. We were tree-dwelling primates. We were hacked into being bipedal. No one would design our paths from scratch. If you wanted to argue against creationism, we're No engineer would build a back like that for an IP organism. But evolution was stuck with what it had. So it could be that it's just its hands are tied in a way. It doesn't have anything to solve it. The problem with this is that both genetic and cultural solutions to the problem, but the problem of intoxication, actually do exist. So let's talk about the genetic solutions first. There is a set of mutations, or actually two separate mutations that happen on unconnected genes, but they happen in conjunction with one another that cause what's sometimes called the Asian flushing complex. So if you have this set of mutations, when you drink even small quantities of alcohol, your face flushes, you get nauseous, you get heart palpitations, it's very unpleasant. It makes you not want to drink. It's so effective in making you not want to drink that a chemical that reproduces this reaction is used as a treatment for alcohol. So if our taste for alcohol is an evolutionary mistake, this is the silver bullet solution. This would be great. It would make you just not want to engage. It's like if you had a gene mutation that caused you to not want to eat Twinkies anymore and just eat kale. That would be great. Right? This gene actually does exist, and it's been around for 7 to 10,000 years. It arose and been around modern day Shanghai. But what's interesting, this is a map of the distribution of it right now. It hasn't moved very much. So it arose in southern southeast China. It spread a little bit in Japan and Korea, but it's kind of sat there. So if this is this ancient solution to an ancient problem, this should have spread to fixation in the entire human species across the world. And yet it hasn't. It just sits in this pretty limited geographic area. So that's a puzzle. We have a genetic solution, but it hasn't taken on that work. Let's talk about cultural evolution. Cultural evolution is even more, in some ways, powerful, and certainly much more fast than genetic evolution. We come up with cultural solutions to problems very quickly. What's the cultural solution to the problem with alcohol? Prohibition. Just tell people they can't drink it. That's a great trick, and maybe pull it off. Didn't work so well in the US. Didn't work so well in ancient China. So I'm an ancient China specialist. One of the earliest written documents we have from early China is a law statute on a bronze vessel saying that anyone caught producing or consuming alcohol should be put to death. That's pretty hardcore prohibition. It was found in a tomb that contained all sorts of massive drinking vessels. Two pumps that obviously used in their lifetime. The Chinese continued drinking uninterrupted to the present day. So prohibition never took off in China. Every culture that we know about that uses alcohol has at one point or another tried to prohibit its use. Because of these perceived dangers, it just doesn't seem to take off. We do have religious groups that forbid alcohol, so Church of Latter-day Saints, Mormons, Muslims, so the Islamic world, with kind of varying degrees of seriousness. So this definitely is a cultural solution that's out there. It's an option on the table. And yet, if you look at a map of where prohibition is now currently in effect, whole or in part, it looks a bit like that map of gene distribution. It exists, it's out there in the world, but it hasn't taken over. And especially, again, given the speed of cultural evolution, if alcohol is purely a mistake, purely cause, this should be the solution, and everyone should be Muslim. None of us should be drinking, and yet we continue drinking for some reason. So what's going on here? When you think, as I do in evolutionary terms, when you see a human behavior that's incredibly costly, and it's ancient, it's ubiquitous, you see everywhere, you see humans, you see genetic and cultural solutions to the problem. See how this problem can be removed by these genetic mutations or cultural mutations, and yet the behavior persists. You think there's got to be something on the other side of it. There's got to be some benefits that are made for these costs. Something has to be keeping the taste for alcohol in both our genetic and our cultural repertoires. It doesn't make sense otherwise. So what might these benefits be? That's the bulk of what drunk is about, is trying to, for the first time, explain both the individual and social benefits of alcohol, and help to explain why it's been preserved in our species. usually it can't have anything to do with pleasure. It's got to be, it can't be that just it makes us feel good, because evolution doesn't care about us feeling good. The benefits have to be something functional. They have to be something that actually matters in the calculus that evolution cares about, which is either individual or group success. So pleasure doesn't count. It's got to be something else. What might these things be? To understand what the functions of alcohol meant for us evolutionarily, historically, we have to understand what we are as species. We're a very odd primate in a variety of ways, one of which is that we're completely dependent on tools and technology. We're so dependent on tools and technology, we biologically adapted to them. So our jaws, our digestive systems, are now adapted to being cooked food. We can't eat raw food anymore. Cooked food is a technological achievement. Babies don't have good food. It's something we figured out as a culture. So we're completely dependent on technology. And that means we're completely dependent on creativity. Because if you're dependent on technology, you've got to come up with new tools. The environment changes, you need new tools. Probably more relevantly, you're competing with a cultural group next door, and they have better tools than you, and employing the environment better. Humans, unlike any other species, are dependent on innovation and creativity. Lions and gazelles do what they do with the tools that they have, that they genetically are given, and that's it. They don't need to invent anything new. You don't see lions sitting around thinking about what to be kind of efficient way. They just do what they're designed to do. Humans are constantly innovating and changing what they do. So we're dependent on creativity in a way that just no other species on the planet is. The problem with creativity is that we get worse at it as we age, as humans. So Allison Gopnik, developmental psychologist at UC Berkeley, has done some great studies where she has invented tasks that to solve them you need to have an insight. You can't just kind of power through A, B, C, D reasoning. You have to have an aha moment of, oh, I see how those things connect. So these are some insight tasks, lateral thinking is sometimes called in psychological literature. What she's found is that if you give people these insight tasks, and she works with everyone from 4-year-old kids up to adults, our performance on insight tasks declines as we age. 4-year-olds are great with these tasks, and adults are terrible. They get very bad at them. What I do in the book is lay this graph of performance on creativity tasks against the maturation of the prefrontal cortex. So as we age, our prefrontal cortex is part of the brain, the last part of the brain to mature. It doesn't mature until you're in your mid-20s, which is really weird. It's surprising to me. It pretty much tracks our decreasing creativity. It's the prefrontal cortex that is making us less creative as it develops and becomes more mature. So what's the deal with prefrontal cortex? Why do we need it? It's a really important part of the human brain. It's the key to what psychologists call cognitive control or executive function. So our ability to delay gratification, to stay focused on tasks. It's the key to doing everything you need to do as a successful adult. If you want to be successful as an adult, you need to have a functioning prefrontal cortex, which is why teenagers should not drink distilled liquors. It's really bad. But the prefrontal cortex seems to interfere with lateral thinking. And it seems to be the case that basically you're trading off flexibility for focus. So we become less able to see connections or see novel things, but you get better able to put your shoes on and get to work on time. And we need to be able to do that as adults. What's interesting is there's got to be a kind of evolutionary trade-off going on. Whenever, again, from an evolutionary perspective, when we see evolution delaying the development of something for so long, there's got to be some kind of trade-off. And I think what's got to be going on is evolution wants us to have the benefits of being a child as long as possible. Because we're a cultural species, we need to be able to learn new things, learn new languages, new skills, we need to be open to new possibilities as long as possible. But at some point, we need to be able to put on a suit and get to work on time and not get wet in the rain. Be able to be a reasonable adult. So it's evolution's got this trade-off that deals with it by slow walking development of different technologies. So at some point, our ability to be creative shuts down so that we can remain focused. So one way to look at this is our ability to use tools effectively shuts down our ability to invent new tools. We're not as able to think of new ideas. What would be great is if we could be adults and have all the knowledge that we had as adults, all the ability to remain focused and know what's relevant for our survival, but have some of that creativity again. If we could temporarily get back to being like a kid again, that would be ideal, just for a few hours. Now, there are ways to do this. So one way is to target the prefrontal cortex with technology. So there's good data that if you use a transcranial magnet to zap the prefrontal cortex, take it offline for a little bit, people get better at creativity tests. You take adults and you zap the prefrontal cortex, they start to look more like 4, 6, 8 creativity tests. The problem with this is that it's a relatively recent technology, it's kind of bulky. If you showed up at a party with this, people well, the ideal is that we had something that had the same function as a transcranial magnet, but it was easy to invent, ancient, paired well with food, tasted nice, see where I'm going. One of the main arguments of the book is that one of the primary functions of alcohol and visual technology is it's like a transcranial magnet taking up the prefrontal cortex. Alcohol, the effect of alcohol on the brain-body system is really complex. It's been called a pharmacological hand grenade. Stephen Brown, a journalist, it's almost like a kid getting all the keys on a keyboard at the same time. It's hitting a lot of different systems. Over the course of intoxication, it's doing different types of things. It's very complex. So it's simultaneously a stimulant. So people tend to think of alcohol as a depressant, but it's actually a stimulant as well. So it's doing both of these things in some cases at the same time. But for the purposes of my story, one of the really crucial functions of alcohol is that it selectively targets the prefrontal cortex. It turns down the prefrontal cortex. It actually deregulates the functioning of this and gets us back to an earlier developmental stage where kids and things wasn't a very important part of our brains. So if you can do this, you can consume a bit of alcohol, you're getting back, at least temporarily, to a kind of childlike state of creativity. And this is why there's a very good reason, you look across the world throughout time, there's a relationship between creativity and artists, poets, creative types, and intoxication seem to go together. And this is often viewed as a cultural myth, but it's not. There's some really good scientific evidence of the connection between creativity and intoxication that explains why we see these patterns of association across cultures. There's interesting, very intriguing indirect evidence. One of my favorite studies that I talked about in the book by an economist, Michael Andrews. He took advantage of a natural experiment, which was American Prohibition. So I always thought American Prohibition happened all at once in China. But this is not the case. It's actually imposed at the county level over a long period of time. So we've got counties at various points becoming dry. He also has access to patent application data at the county level. So he has patent application data as a proxy of group innovation and creativity. He knows when these counties will dry. What he found is that when a county goes dry, patent applications goes dry. And they don't recover for about 3 years. And his theory about why they recover is basically people figure out a different way of doing it. They figure out speakeasies and other ways to get around prohibition. So this is correlational, but it's pretty strong correlational evidence that you take away the ability of people to drink together, groups especially, bad things happen to innovation, to cultural innovation. The only direct study that I know on trade, there's a lot of really good data on suppressing PSC and increasing creativity. Transcranial magnets, people have actually brain damage and strokes. The only one that I know that studies alcohol directly is this study from 2013, I think. where they showed that it get people to about 0.08 PAC. So this is probably where, probably some of you were there. Yeah. Two glasses of wine or two beers in. This is the peak point of creativity. You're much more creative than you are at baseline. So there is something right now that's as opposed to people who made a really good placebo condition as well. It's not just a placebo effect, it actually is the ethanol that's doing it. So we have a way of explaining scientifically why there's always been this association between creativity and alcohol. Let's talk about another weird thing about humans, which is that we're hyper-social. Unlike any other primate, we cooperate in these huge groups, and we're completely dependent on our consequences. We're completely dependent on other people to succeed. And that means we're completely dependent on trust. We need to be able to trust other people to cooperate and solve questions of others together. We constantly, in everyday life, face these cooperation dilemmas. They're built by various names, economists call them various things, and they're structurally sometimes set differently. Prisoner's dilemma, attack of the commons. But the important thing is that the best payoff comes if you cooperate. So if you and I can trust each other and cooperate, we get the best payoff. The problem is that we're vulnerable to being taken advantage of. So the best payoff is if I trust you. But if I trust you and you defect in the economist language and you don't cooperate with me, you do great and I do terribly. So in this type of situation, in a prisoner's dilemma type situation, the only rational strategy is for me to defect. You're going to defect, I'm going to defect, we both are rational agents together, that's how it's going to go. We both get suboptimal outcomes, but at least we're not being taken advantage of. So in economic, and actually if you do this in the lab, economic students and philosophers defect. No other normal human being defects. Human beings solve prisoner dilemmas all the time. So rational agents end up with suboptimal outcomes. Most people solve these dilemmas all the time in their life. And how do they do it? They do it because they're not purely rational agents, because they are motivated by emotion. And this part of the book, I'm very influenced by Robert Frank. So he's an economist at Cornell and has argued that emotions are approximately irrational, but they have a ultimate rational function in allowing us to solve these cooperation dilemmas. So how do I solve a cooperation dilemma? I have a sense of honor. I'm a part of this group and I would feel ashamed to violate by reneging on my agreement. I love you, and so I'm going to remain committed to you even if something bad happens to you. And it's now no longer in my rational self-interest to cooperate. So these emotions are things that bind us together and allow us to cooperate in situations where individual self-interest and rationality would cause us to defect. And humans have to be able to do this if we're going to be able to be successful in groups. Now, so this is great. How do we know that we can actually trust someone? How do we know that they feel honor? How do we know that they love us, that they love God, that we all worship together? We look at their faces. Not just faces, but their voices. We look at their whole kind of body language. So human beings are incredibly sensitive to cues of sincere commitment. So if I'm sizing you up and deciding whether I want to cooperate with you, I'm going to look at your facial expression as the way you talk, where you have to see if you're reliable or cooperating. And that's because emotional displays are not fully under conscious control. They're hard to fake. So here's an example of the famous example, the Duchenne versus non-Duchenne smile. That's Duchenne smile on the left. It's sincere, it's genuine, she's genuinely amused. That's non-Duchenne on the right. They're obviously different. They're controlled by completely different muscle systems. And the first one is typically not under conscious control, and the second one. So this is a relatively hard to fake signal that I find you amusing or happy to be around. We're constantly looking at these signals to decide whether or not we can trust another person. In economic games, in theory, if someone defects by mistake, if they didn't mean to, but they hurt us, you're screwed. You, tit for tat, we're now in a little spiral of non-cooperation. In real life, we fix these all the time like that. I'm really smart. So when we defect through no fault of our own, we can signal it through emotional displays. I feel ashamed, I'm really sorry I didn't show up to help you move your couch, and you helped me move last week, but I really didn't have the flu. We see sincere expressions of regret in other people, and this helps us solve these game problems, economic game situations where I really should defect now because you defected, but I now trust that you didn't need to. And that can keep cooperation going in a way that you don't necessarily see in these abstract simulations. So this is all a great system, it works pretty well. The problem is that if someone really did defect on purpose, but they're able to fake that expression. So the worry now gets pushed to a different level, where you can imagine a defector who's able to fake sincerity and get all the benefits of cooperation, but as soon as push comes to shove, they defect. When every Saturday, when it's time to move your couch, they're not available for some reason. So that's the worry, is that people are going to defect in this kind of more subtle way, under behaviors and emotional displays. What's a way to guard against that? Target your front work. The key to lying, calculating, pursuing your own self-interest is the prefrontal cortex. Especially lying is an incredibly prefrontal cortex heavy operation. If I'm lying to you about something, I've got to simultaneously keep in my mind both what I'm telling you is true and what I know to be true, which are very different things. I need to suppress any emotional expressions or any kind of reactions that relate to what I know is true but not what I'm telling you. I have to fake new emotional expressions that have to do with what I'm telling you is true. It's, you're running the prefrontal cortex at high speed when you're perceiving something. So how do you deal with worries about deception? Take that part of it right now. Also, a little bit less intuitively, the prefrontal cortex interferes with your ability to detect lying. We're worse at detecting liar than we're trying consciously to. That seems to be because we think we know what the cues are and we don't. But our bodies are our subconsciousness. So take out the prefrontal cortex, and you're now, cultures have an interest in favoring the cheater detectors or the cheaters. They want to help people cooperate. And in the same way that powerful cultural technology ramp up group innovation and creativity, it's a cultural technology that helps to get people past these cooperation levels by increasing trust. Also, another effect of alcohol, it's taking out the prefrontal cortex. It's simultaneously boosting serotonin and these other kind of feel-good chemicals that actually make us less likely to want to cheat or dissemble in the first place. They make us feel good about ourselves, good about other people. They make us genuinely more cooperative. So it's a kind of one-two punch that helps us get along with cooperating with people better. So this is a reason, I argue, that in the same way when we meet a new person, especially strangers, we shake hands. The origin of that is to show that we don't have a weapon in our dominant hand. When we meet strangers and we have a couple of drinks, it's like taking our prefrontal cortex out and doing it too. It's mental disarmament. It's telling you that I don't have anything to hide. I'm willing to voluntarily impair my ability to deceive you by consuming this thing that's going to downregulate my DMC. And this is again is why we see alcohol. In the same way that is associated with creativity across the world throughout history, is associated with people getting together and cooperating, trying, especially in high-stakes situations. So any treaty, negotiation, anything in the ancient world, again, China, ancient Greece, it doesn't matter where you are, you get potentially hostile people trying to come to an agreement, the alcohol comes out. And it's for the same reason. Nixon famously said that went to China and drink it at the mountain and solve it. It's this idea that you need this as a way to get beyond potential distrust and come to trust with your counterparty. This is also why, on a more informal level, we use alcohol all the time as a social lubricant. You're meeting new people, you're going on a first date, you want to downregulate your prefrontal cortex, you want to boost your serotonin and endorphin levels, you want to be looser, you want to be more open. This is a very good reason alcohol is used in this way in the kind of social behavior. And this, again, is an ancient, ubiquitous function for alcohol. It's also a reason that the idea of office parties is not crazy. The idea that you get bonding in an organization through letting people let their hair down a little bit is not, you don't need to go too far to go kick the slides and reindeer as a famous office party movie. But there's good empirical evidence that you give people alcohol as opposed to placebos in social situations. They report liking each other more, they report being feeling more bonded, they feel more part of the group. This is the alcohol condition and the Michael Syed study. You can see these are all Duchenne's models. They're genuinely enjoying each other. This is also why Skype was invented. I'm old enough to remember that. It's a really novel thing. And really predicted that business travel would just fall off a cliff. Because why, if I'm in London, why would I fly to Shanghai to sign a business deal when we could just Skype and figure it out online? Business travel remained completely unchanged until the pandemic. And it's now rebounding back to previous levels. Why is that? It's because if you're going to do anything more complex than buy some paper clips from someone, you want to know who they are. And how do you know who they are? Sit down with them over a meal and you drink. So there's a very good reason that people get on airplanes and go fly in person to meet other people. It's because they want to get a sense of whether or not they can trust them. So it's still playing its really crucial function. So again, you've got these costs, and they're real. You can't deny the whole purpose of this book of defending the function of alcohol, and get some pushback on that. But the whole premise of the book is this is a really dangerous substance, and it's really costly to engage in consuming it. So what's going on? What are the benefits on the other side of that? And I also walk through some other individual and group benefits. The group innovation and the trust cooperation are really, I think, the crucial ones. So you have these benefits. This explains why alcohol has been part of our behavioral repertoire for probably as long as we've been here. So this is Venus of Baksan, 20,000-year-old stone carvings from Southwest France. She is drinking something out of that fire, and it is not water. There's no way that some artist was like, oh, she's thirsty, I want to commemorate that. This is a festival of some kind, and she's drinking some sort of intoxicating beverage. You look at sites like Göbekli Tepe, this is in modern day Turkey. Hunter gatherers, so this site's 10 to 12,000 years old. This is thousands of years before agriculture. People are coming together, drinking something. We have these huge vats. We don't have direct chemical residue evidence from this site, but we have direct evidence of beer that came from sites in the region. They're drinking beer, probably just a glazed beer, building these monumental structures, these big stone stelae, doing some feasting, having some kind of ritual. But alcohol was being used as a binding mechanism, as a way to get and 12,000 years ago, way before agriculture. This is actually what I talked about in the book is this movement in archaeology. Sites like the Göbekli Tepe have turned around how they thought about, but in the same way that the standard scientific story is our taste for alcohol is a mistake. The standard historical story is the reason we had alcohol is a mistake. So we invented agriculture first, then someone left some sourdough started out for too long, fermented, tried it, liked it. So alcohol was a byproduct of growing grains for food. The so-called beer before bread movement, which has a lot of support now, argues that the data suggests the opposite, that actually hunter-gatherers started settling down, started cooperating, started cultivating wild foods, or wild plants, in order to get drunk. The first cultivated plants around the world have been selected for their psychoactive properties, not for their nutrition properties. So this is a way, in a very literal sense, that our taste for intoxication led to civilization. Our desire to brew more and better beer is what caused us to settle down in certain cultures. This is why when you look around the world, you see this ubiquitous use of alcohol in social situations. And in the rare cultures that don't have alcohol, you see them substituting some other type of intoxicant. So kava, sometimes cannabis, sometimes usage of nice tobacco. But when you see this, again, from an evolutionary perspective, you see that when the substance doesn't exist, something very similar is taking its place. It suggests that it's a very important function each that needs to be filled. And it's not being filled by alcohol, it's getting filled by something else. So the function of alcohol is so crucial, I think, because we're climbing. So we're basically, in terms of our biological instincts, we're not that different from our chimpanzee relatives. I flew here on a plane. The plane from Denver to Lubbock, the tiny, stuck next to other people. Tracked up a bunch of chimpanzees on a plane like that, and at the other end we didn't have two full bloody hearts. They're gonna kill each other. There's no way strange primates would cooperate and be docile the way that human beings are. So we are biologically primates, but if you look at our behavior, we cooperate with an intensity and a scale that looks a lot more like social insects than like primates. So there's this trick we pull off of the put in the book, kind of hammering the square primate peg into this round social insect hole. We have to figure out how to change our basic patterns of behavior. And my argument is that alcohol is one of the cultural technologies we use to pull this off. And there are other ones. Religion is another one that I've done a lot of work on as well. And they're often synergistic. They're often used together. So the ancient Greeks worshipped Dionysus as a god. This is a couple of benefits that he gives to you. But he was also, it's important to realize that he lived in a dream. So he gave gifts, but they weren't always the gifts we thought they were. So famously, he gave Midas the gift of golden touch, which didn't work out so well for Midas. So the Greeks had a very ambivalent attitude toward Dionysus. They worshipped him as a god. He's the god of intoxication and wine. But they were also a little afraid of him. And I think that that's a good attitude to have. All of the positive benefits that I talked about sociality, people letting their hair down, learning to share with each other, have dark other sides. So broism, people forming cabals, old boy networks. For every kind of happy, kind of loose, at a party person, there's somebody who can't hold their alcohol and gets violent. There's alcohol that leads to domestic violence, social violence. So almost every function that I talk about has a dark side as well. And we have to be aware of that. Especially because, I don't have time to get into it now, but if you treat, we talk about the Q&A, alcohol has become much more dangerous in the last couple of 100 years because of changes in the way we use it, and also the access to things like distilled liquor, which is a novel and really dangerous form of alcohol. So we need to be cautious. And there are various harm reduction strategies you can use, being mindful about drinking, using, we have actually now something, a new technology that we have that's very helpful, is non-alcoholic versions of beverages that finally taste good. So this helps level the playing field socially between drinkers and non-drinkers. You see people shaking their heads. There's also some decent tasting alcoholic beers now. Non-alcoholic wines are universally awful. They still haven't figured that out. But this is a helpful technology. There's various strategies we can use to try to capture the benefits of alcohol, which tended to basically come in about 0.08 BAC, without falling into the dangers of it. I run through this in the last chapter of the book. So I want to conclude by talking about this myth about Dionysus. This is the first account we have of Dionysus. Ancient Greek and some sailors, pirates, are sailing along the coast. They see a well-dressed, wealthy-looking guy on the coast. They say, let's kidnap him. Some ransom. Only the helmsman says, no, leave that guy alone. That's something special. You don't want to touch him. But they ignore him. They capture this young man. And as soon as they take him on board and set sail, all hell breaks loose. The mast starts sprouting grapes. The sea turns into wine. And Dionysus reveals himself. This wealthy young man is actually Dionysus in disguise. He turns himself into a lion. Attacks the sailors, and they jump into the sea, and when they hit the water, they turn into dolphins. They lose use their humanity. Now, what I love about this and Greek myths in general is they can pack a lot of information into a short story. At the end, the helmsman is the only one who survives, and he is blessed by Dionysus for recognizing him and giving great blood to him. This long, prosperous life. If you don't recognize the power of Dionysus and you don't respect him, you can't be human. You turn into a beast. That's one message in the story. Another message is at the end of the hymn, it praises Dionysus and it says, "Those who deny you can no longer create sweet song." So I think the message of this myth is we have to be worried about Dionysus. We need to treat him with respect, but also be cautious of his danger and his power. But also recognize that as this creative, cooperative species, we need to make a space in our lives for ecstasy, for intoxication, if we're going to continue to be, to make sweet song, to be this creative, cooperative, wildly successful primate. So thanks very much.